welcome to the Epic Journey Day 36. An epic journey in which I intend to take you through a whole year of lessons, a lesson a day, every day for an entire year. My name is DaleneFM and today we're going to be talking about the different types of composition in art and how to put them together. So now we're looking at types of compositions, and the first thing that I want to draw your attention to is something that we haven't really discussed yet in detail, and that is the diagonal composition. Now we've got this little Bojana Petkova painting in the window here with the rule of thirds lines drawn on it, so you can see exactly where the composition elements fall. And as you can see, if we draw a line from diagonally across the canvas, it follows nicely the line of the ballerina, and then from our central focal point, which is almost on the rule of thirds crisscross, we draw a line to the bottom, and then we can do the same on the other side. And we can see how the artist can use one, two, or three of these lines to create interest and offset, off-balance interest in the canvas, just like Bojana Petkova has done in this particular canvas. She's also put our central focal point, which is the face tucked behind the arm. We can see the bit of the ear and the dark part of the hair right on that rule of thirds junction. If you can have a look, I've got next to it here the lines drawn from the rule of thirds, and those are the four junctions that we discussed yesterday. The ideal is to put your central focal point onto one of those four junctions, and this is what Bojana Petkova has actually done here. So effectively, the bottom half of the canvas diagonally is where all the interest lies, and the top half of the canvas on the left-hand side, there is little or no interest. So the canvas is completely weighted to the right-hand side, but to the lower diagonal right-hand side. The next thing we want to talk about is the rule of odds. We haven't discussed it very much in detail. The rule of odds is that we simply should not have an even number of elements. If you have four elements in a painting, it's just a little less interesting than if you only had three or five. For some reason or other, the human brain likes the odd numbers, and compositionally we find it much more interesting. That becomes less evident when you've got seven or more. It's only up until five that it actually really applies, because from seven onwards, we become unconscious almost of how many elements there are. It's as if from seven onwards, our brain doesn't stop to count them. Even having three, like I've got three, three little trees in a frame, just having three little trees is not actually going to be good enough. It's the way we group them that's important. If we had three trees spaced evenly apart, it's not going to be as interesting than if we had three trees of different sizes grouped together on the one side of our canvas. Alternatively, we could have one tree on the one side and another two smaller trees on the other side, one large tree here on the left, and then two smaller trees on the right. And then what happens is visually they get balanced. If you remember, we went back to the conversation of the fulcrum, they are now balanced. So one larger tree balances with the two smaller trees. But we've still only got three elements. This, of course, would also work with five. But again, we get any more than five, it becomes irrelevant. And then it's just a forest of trees in our minds. Now we're having a look at a composition with only one tree in the middle. That is what is commonly known as the sentinel composition. Now, it's relevant to anything that has one single element. So, and it doesn't matter where it is, whether it's in the middle or to the sides. It's not important. The sentinel is a composition that contains only one element. This is something that Van Gogh used quite a lot with his cypress trees, where he just put one cypress tree either to the one side or in the middle, but it was one tree. It's a very powerful statement of strength and vulnerability at the same time. Okay, the next thing we're going to have a look at is the T, which is perfect balance. And perfect, I use that word very loosely because it's not always a good thing to use the T composition. What I'm drawing here is a little lighthouse. At the moment it's looking like a cross. We'll make it look more like a lighthouse. Now this is using your central focal point slap bang in the middle of your canvas, which we will discuss a little bit later on down the bottom of this page, is not ideal to do. But in the case of the T composition, it can be very useful. Because effectively what you've got is your vertical composition in the middle of your canvas, and you've got your horizontal at the bottom of your canvas in this case, which would be your seascape, which is grounding your composition. The upright T shape works in exactly the same way. It would possibly be a tree and a skyline high up on the horizon. Your tree takes up the center of your painting. Your brightly pale skies, for example, with lots of clouds at the top, so your painting will be weighted to the top. And this has the same effect. You've got your central focal point that lies slap bang in the middle of your canvas, but you've made it work because you've weighted it at the top in this case. The T-shaped composition is taking a central focal point that is placed slap bang in the middle of the canvas and giving it a top or bottom weighting to offset the weight so that your central focal point doesn't become an uninteresting composition. Now, your X composition can be quite interesting. It is very often used when doing figurative type work. In this case, I'm drawing a little farmer plowing a field. You'll see it'll take shape in a minute. But what's happening here is we've got the diagonal line of the body, and now as you can see, the hoe that he's busy plowing his field with will come in, and that will be the opposite diagonal. So this is a composition that is taking into account opposite diagonals from left to right, top to bottom of your canvas. Now this works really, really well because it's a very active composition. Even in a still life, there's a lot of leading lines going in opposite directions on this particular composition. So even in a still life, it is a very active composition. Now what would be even better would be to move your farmer slightly to the right-hand side of the canvas to put your central focal point over one of the intersections on the rule of thirds lines. And you've also then got the X, and you've got your canvas weighted on the right-hand side, so your fulcrum is beautifully balanced as well. So here we've got a much better idea of a composition using the X because of where the central focal point lies. So of those two compositions, the farmer on the left is not incorrect, but the farmer on the right is much more interesting because of the unevenness and because of placing the central focal point on one of those intersections of the rule of thirds. Now we're talking about the S composition. The curvature of the S being the way that the leading lines are guiding our eye through the painting. This is very indicative of paintings that communicate grace and sensuality. So if we have a look at a little landscape with, say, a river snaking through the landscape, it's going to communicate to us a certain amount of grace and serenity. And of course, we can put a little tree on the riverbank to add a little bit of central focal point detail. Now the sensuality comes in, of course, when you start working with your S-bend in nudes. Very, very commonly used compositional element for working with nudes. The shape of the curvature of the body leads your eye in an S direction down the length of the body. So this is the V composition, which is going to communicate depth in one way or another in your painting. It's very commonly used with something that shows a lot of perspective, like a street scene. You're going to have the zooming effect going horizontally into your painting. So you've got this enormous feeling of depth that you can create using a V composition. And as you can see there, we've got that V shape that ends up being negative space at the top of our painting. And then in landscapes, it's equally effective with hills on either side, possibly a little river snaking down the middle of your valley. We've got some foreground interest possibly in a tree, but what it's doing is, again, is it's giving us the sense of depth in the painting, where we've got the valley zooming horizontally forward in front of us with this V-shaped skyline. The Y-shaped composition was used very extensively by the old masters when they were doing a lot of religious type paintings, where it would be used to generate a sense of power, of authority, and of worship. Of course, this can be used in landscapes as well, where you might have a tree of that shape, but generally it's used with figurative work, and generally it's used with religious figurative work. Now what I'm drawing here is simply a bit of a canyon, like one of the paintings that we had a look at earlier on, where the walls of the canyon form the depth of the painting. And instead of it being a V composition, it can be a Y composition also, communicating power and strength. Now the L composition is a beautiful composition, often referred to as a rectangular composition, where you have your central focal point on the extreme left-hand side, grounded by a horizontal element. In the case of the tree and the horizon line, you could have it when you're doing figurative painting or drawing a nude sitting by a window, although she may not necessarily have to be a nude. You have a figure sitting by a window with a curtain behind her, looking out of a window. You place her on the extreme left hand side of the painting, and what she's sitting on, or the windowsill, or whatever the elements are that you're using in your composition, can be in the lower part of the painting, and that creates your rectangular composition. I've decided to split this composition talk into 2 days so that we don't have too long a video. So come back tomorrow to watch the part 2 of our composition chat before we move on to perspective. Please don't forget to like and share and subscribe to the YouTube channel, and I'll see you tomorrow. That's bye. What you want to do.